moment has come. This is the first ever episode of the Buddy Ruski Show. For those of you that haven't heard the trailer, please go check that out to learn more about the show, where it's headed, or the premise for all of this. It really comes down to storytelling. And I'm really excited to have my first ever guest here to talk a little bit about his story, his upbringing in Durham, where he's been the last few years or so, and his return back to Durham as well. Nick Wallhausser, thank you for coming on the show.
No, thank you. I think I'm a terrible storyteller, but let's get these
your story is interesting regardless. I'll guide you through it. I will be your captain today as we navigate this, what I think is a pretty interesting story. You grew up here in Durham. Have you always been interested in music? For some of you that don't know Nick, Nick is a big part of the DJ and hip-hop scene here in the Triangle, one of the founders of Raund Haus Music Collective record label that puts on really, really awesome showcases for all the talented beat makers that are here in the Triangle area and beyond. But have you always been interested in music, or were you more of a jock maybe back in the day and made a transformation in your adult life?
I'm not I don't do athletic stuff anymore, but I still might be jockish occasionally. I don't know yet. But let's see, music-wise, I think that began before sports ever did for me. I went to EK Poe, actually, where you had people, a lot of musicians and artists, some being Duncan Webster of Hammer and Beauty World, Stephen Kaufman, who drummed for Who's Bad and is now in The Beast, Pierce Freelon, you know,
roster's deep
candidate. And I mean, you have people that are doing music still today that I'd gone to elementary school with. Will Goebel, jazz bassist aficionado. So music was there. And then in middle school and especially high school, sports took over for me. Pretty much.
And is that just because of the opportunities that were available to you in the music program? Was it just not as strong? You were being drawn towards sports more? Was it something with your friends that were there like, hey, you know, come instead of sitting in your basement making beats, come play lacrosse or come play soccer or whatever with us? How did you decide on? Because that's a tough thing. I mean, every kid goes through that where they're interested in a million things. And then as you get older, you have to. Maybe you don't have to, but a lot of people end up dropping things to really focus on one craft. So how did you come to that determination?
Let's see. It was right around when DSA first opened. So Durham School of the Arts.
Are you that old?
I am. I think so. I graduated in 02. So I don't remember when DSA began, but I think it was when I went to middle school. And a lot of the more, you know, arts and music driven people went to DSA, where I went to Brogdon. And I think it was that split that really, you know, I ended up playing, I don't know, whatever sports in middle school. And not losing touch of those people, but like didn't see them every day and, you know, didn't play in bands with them. Didn't do our like Red Hot Chili Peppers cover bands or whatever it could have been.
Was that a thing?
I don't think so. It was probably more Nirvana, but one or the other.
And so while they're focused, because DSA is known for, you know, it's School of the Arts, right?
Yeah.
They've got music and theater and all these different things. Brogdon, I went to Brogdon as well, didn't lack arts programs, but certainly not known for churning out musicians and visual artists in the way that DSA is. So you go to Brogdon and you end up at Riverside and kind of in the athletics track. Are you still working on music kind of behind the scenes while you're doing that?
Not too much then. I think Fruity Loops, cracked versions of Fruity Loops started to really appear during my junior or senior year of high school. And definitely had one of those.
Well, and music really downloading fun too. I mean, that was when
LimeWire,
Napster, Kazaa, LimeWire, all those P2P downloading services. You had all this music available to you. So,
yeah.
And not just music, but samples and beats and things like that. So it really unlocked the ability to make music for a lot of people that couldn't afford to go to studios. You know, the home studio really became a thing for a lot of young folks.
Yeah. The music downloading, I think, I don't know. When you ask if music's always been a part of what I did, music listening was definitely in high school. And I was big into like underground hip hop, which there was no outlet for it in Durham, North Carolina.
Yeah.
Like zero, you know, right. Especially for like a 16-year-old. So
yeah, I mean, who's big in when you're in high school? Who are the big artists? I mean, not really around here that I can think. Because Little Brother, they might have been small ciphers on Central's campus at that point, but they certainly weren't on the radio. They weren't even regionally known at that point. So who are you listening to?
From around here?
Or just in general, what are your tastes as a young Nick Wallhauser coming up through high school?
Man, I really, as soon as I figured out that, you know, through the internet, because I mean, yeah, like you said, music downloading had like just began, perhaps, and finding like all this underground stuff, like Binary Star.
I loved that album.
Like,
yeah,
that was a big one. Cannibal Ox and all that stuff, but that you're looking at more early 2000s there. I'm trying to think late 90s.
So definitely more in the underground scene then, instead of like top 40 sort of pop rap.
Totally.
That sounds like that was more your steez. Was mine as well. My dad did music and was a DJ when I was coming up, but as soon as I learned about Jurassic 5 for the first time and got really into their music, that led me to so many other groups and artists that I fell in love with, and downloading made it so easy to just go online and get entire catalogs. I know that the artists probably hate hearing that because they're not making any money on it, but I hope that I paid it forward in some respects as I got older and got a job and made my own money. But it really helped me, and I'm sure you as well, become just huge fans of these artists, and an opportunity to delve into different subgenres of hip hop. So you're at Riverside, you're playing lacrosse, maybe not doing as much music, but you graduate from Riverside and you go off to college for lacrosse. Is that right?
Yeah. So I played lacrosse for 3 years of college, and I quit my senior year.
Yeah. Oh wow.
And to this day, I cannot watch a lacrosse game, even think about playing it.
So. Was there a path forward for lacrosse at that point? Like, say you'd done it 4 years in college. Where were you in school?
I did 1 year at Guilford, and then I did 3 years at Queens University.
Okay. Yeah.
Which I thought I was going to New York. And then I went for the trip to see the campus, and the address was Charlotte.
I was so pissed.
But yeah, so I played there as well.
You just committed anyway.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't enjoy Greensboro, and that freshman year was pretty like hectic.
Yeah,
nothing against either, you know, that school, but
to each his own.
Yeah, I don't know. I left. I couldn't get through my senior year of. Or imagining like playing lacrosse and getting through my senior year, so I quit lacrosse.
And is that just because there was no outlet for? I mean,
no.
Even to this day, there's barely like major league lacrosse. Right.
It exists.
It's out there, but
I just got burnt out. Like, yeah. I mean, big props to all student athletes because balancing time in the gym, time at practice, and class time. It's like stupid hard, you know. And I just got completely burnt out, and so quit, and then, yeah.
and were you, had music been reintroduced into your life at that point? Was
Definitely.
There kind of a switch for you, or like, I'm not going to do lacrosse, maybe I can reinvent myself, reinvest in my passion in music?
Music came back, yeah. I mean, during my freshman year, or my senior year of high school, I guess, with the Fruity Loops.
Yep.
I was kind of like, all right, this is cool. Sample some stuff, make some like beats, and then either my freshman or sophomore year of college, I was given an MPC 2000, and messed around on that. That was a lot of fun. Fruity Loops was always still way easier, but I did some projects through college. Worked with a dude down in South Carolina named Illcraft. That was pretty fun. Actually traveled down there.
Nice.
That was pretty cool. It was like my sophomore year probably. And then worked with some people around, you know, Charlotte that was, they were all doing some cool stuff. Dante Fox, Royalty. I don't know if any of these guys are active anymore. But,
well, and so this is...
This is like 04, right. 05, yeah. 05, 06.
So even then, I mean, the internet was around. It was a thing, but like social networking wasn't... I think Facebook was founded in 06.
Yeah.
Twitter might have been around. Instagram certainly wasn't around. YouTube was barely a thing. So this idea of being able to just blast your music out into the ether and people find it is just not...
We used SoundClick. SoundClick.com and MySpace. MySpace was big.
MySpace, yeah.
Yeah,
MySpace was great. People really forget how like revolutionary MySpace was at the time and what people were doing with it. I remember talking to somebody a week ago about website building and how a lot of people learned early programming just because they wanted to mess around on their MySpace. They wanted to have glittery backgrounds and make their name all weird and abstract on the homepage and do all this stuff. And I think MySpace and Tumblr both were, you know, that's what like made programming not just for the the geeks. You know?
I was always jealous of those people with the cool profiles. I never looked into it.
Yeah. But MySpace is like, that served as people's Facebook pages, as their band pages. It was the destination for all this stuff and really lasted a lot longer than people remember. It had a lot of crossover with Facebook before Facebook kind of just ate up social networking. So yeah, I mean, you had to travel, to your point about going to South Carolina, going to Charlotte. To get a name for yourself, you had to be in front of people. You couldn't really rely on the internet to put your stuff out there.
Well, I mean, I guess you could. And I still don't know how to get people to actually listen to anything, but it's, you know, that's always the struggle. But yeah, that was weird times for, I think, you know, music. But MySpace did its job pretty well, I think. I've learned about Flying Lotus through MySpace, and I was like, he had just released 1983, that record. And I MySpace messaged him like, yo, will I be able to buy this in North Carolina? And he's like, yeah, you'll be able to buy it everywhere. You know, and I'm like, whoa, cool. So props to Flying Lotus for being good to his fans on MySpace back in 2000, whatever
year. That loyalty is important, man.
Yeah, man. I've been a fan since. So that did a good job. But before that was, so I guess more in my high school years, music was really hard.
Mm-hmm. So then you're done with school and maybe you're thinking about a career in music.
No.
Not at all.
No.
Even though you've been hustling, you've been traveling, you're like, you're not looking to, to make this
I'm
a full-time thing.
I'm still trying to figure out what I want to be.
What did you major in?
Philosophy.
Okay. Philosophy, hip hop, those are right in the same family.
Sure. Yeah. Maybe so.
But with that in mind, you've graduated, you've got your degree. What are you thinking is next for you, if not music?
So when I transferred, I ended up at UNC Charlotte, great school. I think I had fun there. It was cool to just be a student, but, they made me take a foreign language class. Mm-hmm. And like, I've always been terrible at Spanish. I got kicked out of French in middle school. They were like, just go take like PE twice. And, I was cool with that.
That is a failure of the system right there.
I mean, maybe.
Get out of our face, kid. Just go run.
I mean, I guess
more.
I was really nice and they liked me, so they let me do a double P. Yeah, I never wanted to take German. So I end up taking Japanese. And the teacher liked me a lot. And the teacher was just like, you should go study abroad. And I was like, I got to graduate. Like, I'm on year 4.5 right now.
Clock is ticking.
Yeah, pretty much. Or year 4, I guess. And then it would be like a fifth year would be studying abroad if I do it. And I was like, yeah, there's no way. And like studying abroad is awesome because, I mean, you pay your like regular tuition and you get to go like have a totally different experience. So I did it. And so, yeah, ended up in Japan for a year.
Had you been thinking about study abroad at all before that? Would you have?
I didn't even know it was an option.
Yeah.
I had no idea. It would, never would it cross my mind.
It's a lot different than it is now. People, you're almost forced to look at study abroad options now in college because they want you to have a more diverse experience, and just the ability to actually travel is that there's less barriers to entry, so you can, you know, you can get to places a little bit easier. The connections are a lot stronger between universities here and abroad as well. So kids now, if they say, oh yeah, I studied abroad here, like, oh, that makes sense. Most kids are, and if they're going to university, but then it wasn't nearly as much of an opportunity.
It's yeah. a great thing. I think everyone should do it.
Yeah, know? Absolutely.
But yeah, I guess so. I did that, came back, and so finally graduated after a little bit of a delay. And then that leaves me where...
Hey, man, it took me 9 years to go from high school graduation to walking and getting that diploma, so...
That's pretty good.
Again, to each his own, man. It's a journey. It's not everyone's story is going to be the same. And so, yeah, 4 years, that's the average, right?
Well, I ended up doing five,
okay.
I think. Five and a half.
Okay.
Five and a half.
But you had to transfer. You had to study abroad, so.
Yeah, I transferred like three times, man. Yeah. I think twice. But yeah, I ended up graduating with a philosophy degree, a experience of a year in Japan, and I definitely wasn't excited about Charlotte as a city. And at that point, so we're looking at like 07, like I didn't have any ideas of coming back to Durham either. Yeah. So I was like, screw this.
And what would you have come back to? I mean, Durham,
right? I think the Federal existed then.
Yeah.
Bull McCabe's was maybe about to open.
And American Tobacco had just started, mm-hmm. but no one really knew what that was. Startups was not popping like it is now. And so coming back to Durham, you're like, well, what am I coming back to?
Yeah, I would have nothing. But I enjoyed Japan so much that year abroad. That was just like, screw it. I'm going to go back and I'm going to stay for at least 5 years.
And so you had that in your mind, 5 years. Bare minimum, I'm going to be in Japan when you took off.
I said three.
Okay.
And I was like, but no longer than five.
Okay.
And I mean, that's what happened.
So that study abroad experience must have been really transformative for you to think about spending time, you know, your young years in Japan, in a foreign country.
Yeah, for sure. I'd say so. That year, it's like,
you must not have gone to class very much then.
No, I didn't. I mean, we had, you know, it was like 3 hours, or what was it? It was like 4 hours a day of like, no English was used. It was hard. It was the hardest school stuff I'd ever done. Or maybe I just was never going to class ever.
How good was your Japanese going into study abroad?
Terrible.
You would have had, what, a semester of it?
Yeah, I had a semester of it. And that, you know, that's, I don't even know.
But you were able to get by on Japanese English?
I mean, not really.
But you still committed.
Yeah.
That's impressive. I don't know a ton of people that would have made that leap, maybe. Especially to go to another English-speaking country, you go to, you know, the UK, Australia, or something like that.
Australia, animals are trying to kill you, so that wasn't an option, man. I mean, it's like how... Here in, I don't know, and I remember everyone had Spanish class,
right?
You know, growing up here, and it's the same there. Like everyone has English class,
right?
It's just like how much is it used? Like I can't speak Spanish, and I, you know, I took it from whatever grade they started teaching us.
I was also in that camp. I didn't want to take Spanish, maybe because I wanted to be a contrarian. I don't know what it was, but I just felt like everyone's learning Spanish. I don't need this. I'm going to go learn Italian or Japanese was also high on my list. I watched a ton of anime growing up. So I was like, you know, it'd be really nice to not have to have subtitles. If I could just understand what they were saying, I could watch it reading half the time. So, so you end up in Japan, 5 year plan. What are you thinking about when you move there? You're just like, I'm going to get a bartending job. I'm going to teach English, kind of how are you going to make a life for yourself in Japan?
I knew that teaching English was the quickest like ticket in, and mm-hmm. like the only thing you need to do that is a college degree. And so like I had a college degree, And
did your professors have anything to do with you making connections there? Did you lean on them at all to try and get a job?
Not at all. I wanted to get back to the same city I studied abroad in, which is Nagoya. It's like a 2.5 million person city. Great city. I love it. But I knew I wanted to go back there, so I was just looking at English schools, and I happened to find one. And like usually this is like a month-long process or more. But this school I find, it's like a privately owned, very small school. It's not like a school. It's like kids come there after school to learn. Mm. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like is Sylvan Learning Center still a thing?
I don't know.
You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like kids would go after their regular school day and learn. That's what this was like. And the dude, he was like, you know, I had one interview, it went well. And then he was like, this is weird to ask, but would you be down to come here illegally in the next week?
Oh, wow.
Like before the visa process goes through. And I'm just like, hell yeah. Like, you mean I don't have to worry about like working some like lame job for a month or two here in Charlotte? You know what I mean? So I went from like an interview to being back in Nagoya, beginning this, you know, English teaching job within a week. And so, and that was probably like 3 weeks after graduation.
Yeah. So you had not even spent a whole year back in the States between study abroad then and...
It was like 5 months.
Yeah.
Maybe. Yeah.
That's a quick turnaround.
Really short. Came back, graduated, and 2 or 3 weeks later, I was back in Japan. So yeah, taught English.
And did you do that the whole 5 years? Was that sort of your anchor job?
Not really. I did that for 2 years, and then I taught just at a regular middle school for 3 years.
What is teaching like for you as someone who's, it sounds like education, teaching was never really like something that you considered as a career path. I could be wrong, but in our conversations, it sounds like that wasn't really on your mind, but now you're thrust into this position where you are in charge of other people's children.
True, true. Well, yeah. At the middle school, it was like team teaching.
Okay.
So that was pretty cool.
Is it pretty similar to the States in terms of how the schools are run? Do you have classes?
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, there, the students have their class and the teachers move. So that was pretty weird. But it's kind of cool because it really builds like unity in the classroom, I think. But yeah, the schools there are definitely different. Teaching English there, it was like, that was the one class, like they got to kind of not be stuck with their head in a book. So like these kids really, like some of them really, most of them really looked forward to English class because it was like, yo, you're going to have this goofy American cat up in there, and I don't know, we're probably gonna play some trivial or some kind of trivia game and with English, or you know, I don't know. That was like the big thing, like you had some
freedom, right, to teach maybe the way that you wanted to teach. Was music a part of that at all? You said but it's music is something that translates across.
We did Run DMC's Christmas in Hollis every year right around Christmas time. We'd learn that, and none of the kids could pull the raps off, but we'd all get down and listen to some Run DMC. That's probably as close as the music gets.
And at this time, are you, what is music like for you in your own life? Are you still making
out there
beats? Because hip hop is a big part of the Japanese music scene and has been for some time.
Yeah.
You and I have definitely talked about Nujabes, who's was a music producer, hip hop beat maker, really, really talented guy, kind of in that same esteem as J Dilla for a lot of folks. Passed away early in his life, way too soon. But he was probably coming around the time that you were in Japan.
He's a little before. He died, I think my first or second year back. Like, he was definitely alive and running a really cool record store in Tokyo when I studied abroad. I went. It was a very cool experience. And then, yeah, he died of, like, 2 years later, so it was unfortunate. And I remember going back to that record store, and it was closed after he died, and that was a pretty emotional time.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
So music then is still something that you're dabbling in, even though you're teaching full-time in
Japan?
No,
music there I was doing very heavily. A lot of just beat making at the house, a lot of collaboration with Japanese rappers that, you know, from Nagoya. I was DJing a lot more then. I was the hype man for a DJ. We had this little, like, the Jazzy Jeff and Mad Skills, you know, kind of dynamic going on. So that was pretty fun.
And are they doing music in English and Japanese?
The guys I was working with?
Yeah.
No, they were all pretty much, you know, 98% of it was in Japanese. Mm-hmm. And they'd throw out, like, Texas Pete
or something. Yeah, right.
In the rhyme.
Yeah, some, you know? Some things just don't translate.
Right, right. But, yeah, that was all Japanese. It really, and working with them, you know, going to the hip hop shows and working with people, it really forced me to learn the language too. So that was cool.
Point. So then, so your 5 years are up. You've,
oh yeah.
Whew. You've spent what, right out of college, you'd have been 22. So most of your 20s have spent.
Yeah.
And spent in Japan.
Yeah, yeah.
And then you come back to Durham immediately after Japan?
Yeah. I went, yes, pretty much.
And what's the tipping point? What makes you finally decide? Is it this pact that you've made with yourself 5 years ago to say, you know, I gave myself 5 years, that time is up, it's time to go home? Or were you burned out from being in Japan? What is it that influenced you to decide now's the time for me to come home?
Right. Well, I was burnt out from teaching for sure. I had also been working at like a cafe and bar during the last like 3 years in Japan, and that was really fun. But I knew that it was like I can stay here, like do this cafe bar thing. I'm over teaching at this point. And I also thought that if I didn't leave, I would like never leave.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I didn't, and I still think about going back to Japan. And I know if I do, it's going to be like for the long, you know, the long haul. Like, there's no like, oh, let me go do another year. It's like, I'm going to go do another like 20 years. And then
What is it about Japan that is calling you there?
I mean, I enjoy bigger cities for sure. I learned over there, and that was like a 2.5.
We do have those here in the United States.
True, true. We do. But there specifically, it's like the level of convenience through like public transportation, I guess just people's like etiquette in general. Like there's no like real stepping on toes. The food, I mean the music as well. Like the nightlife there is way crazier. Not that I necessarily party hard or not party hard. Don't party hard. I'm not sure, but there people cut way loose and have a good time.
But is there something about being in Japan that you feel like you can't get here? Not necessarily in Durham, but in any city in the United States. Because, you know, there's New York, LA, Miami.
Yeah.
You know, there are places where partying is a big part of the culture. Music's a big part of the culture.
For sure.
Etiquette maybe not as strong in New York.
Yeah.
I haven't spent too much time there, but I don't get the sense that there's a strong sense of
personal
space. I mean,
the food, man. And as we said, like food, bar, music, like that's it for me. Those three things. For now.
Yeah, sure.
And just the food there really worked for me. And Nagoya specifically. Mm-hmm. Like nowhere else in Japan really you know, draws me as much as that. The food there is considered very heavy and rich by other people in Japan. So like that kind of fits well for someone from the South. Like
yeah.
They're used to like salty, buttery food. There it's like, you know, saltier food. It's just like heavier flavors. That's where red miso is from. They're like one of the famous places. for it, a specific type. And it's just a real rich miso. So it's like that whole city has super rich kind of palates. So the food, yeah, I can't get that food anywhere else for sure.
Yeah. So that's, we're going to take a quick break here, but I want to continue that conversation about food, because I know that is a point of contention for you here back in Durham, but we're going to take a quick break and we'll come back and hash this out with Nick. So are you thinking about doing music when you come back to Durham, or coming out of teaching in Japan? How much is music playing into your career path? Is it teaching? Is it education? What are you looking at in this new Durham that you're experiencing?
Right, right. I mean, music for me is still, I'm a hobbyist when it comes to music, I'll say. Maybe very, pretty serious hobbyist at times, but to me it's not a kind of career goal. I don't want to be a beat maker or musician necessarily, but I'll always do it.
Yeah. Like, is that just because the difficulty of cracking into that market is so high, or it's just not, you're not passionate enough in it to really pursue it as a full-time career?
I guess if I were to take it seriously, I would do it a lot more. You okay. know what I mean? And to do it seriously, I'd have to like give up a lot of other stuff.
So music is a hobby for you. What are you thinking about day to day that you're trying to get to? Yeah. I mean, you gotta make a living.
Well, let's see. I'd look
Japanese
at
Japanese culture is deeply rooted in your story now, in your daily life. So to go from whatever it was that you were doing in Japan to coming back here, it's not just a shift in your professional career. It's like a totally different shift in a way of life that you have to do all over again. And so, yeah, what are you thinking of? What's going through your head when you're like, okay, how do I get back integrated into American culture, American society at this point?
Right. I had, I mean, I knew like I wasn't going to get into teaching, and I still looked at some options. Like there's no way I was going to go back to school to get like a teaching degree. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I had looked at like a few like grad programs at Central, but then like, I was like, I don't want to take these GREs. You're like, screw this. And 5 years teaching English abroad, philosophy degree, like, what's the best bet? Like, working in a bar. So, ended up working at Motor Co.
And so, in 2014, not only are there bars and restaurants, but there's a scene that's being established. So, the bars are starting to pick up steam. People are coming back downtown. So, it's not a bad time, I guess, to start a career as a bartender or bar manager. And that's where I think a lot of people would recognize you from, is your time at Motor Co. and now at Accordion and Quarter Horse. But you're just jumping into this in 2014. And again, you have this experience from being in Japan. So now you have to rethink your approach.
Yeah, it was, I mean, it was some pretty wild, reverse culture shock, I guess.
It's culture like shock. Back. Yeah.
Coming back to where you're from.
Even if it's your original culture, it can still be culture shock. Yeah.
It's like walking through the neighborhood and someone just being like, hey, you know, it's like, what? Like, what does this person need? So that definitely happened. And
so you start bartending, you're at Motor Co. mostly at this point. I think that's where I started.
No, that's where I only worked at Motor Co. for a while until I started at Baxter out in Chapel Hill. So I was juggling those two for a bit as well. But, I don't know. I knew some people at Motor Co. already, had connections to it, and it was just kind of automatic job kind of thing.
Almost. Are you bartending in Japanese at this point? Have you relearned English?
No, I bartended in Japan. At Motor Co., I started out running French fries, man. Mm. That was great. It was a lot of fun. And then eventually bartended there as well. But yeah, so I guess motor coach just made sense, really. And it was a fun time, or still is a fun time, to work in bars, as you're saying. There is like a social aspect to it. Especially now, like Quarter Horse being kind of in the center of downtown, you get a lot of like people who just moved here, people visiting who like don't know that Rigsby's probably your best bet for nightlife. It's like they'll stumble down to the barcade and they're like, "We're from Austin. This is great." You know, and it's like, it's pretty cool. It's interesting to, you know, kind of receive those people to the city and be like, "Oh yeah, you know, you're looking for this. Go here, go here, go there."
Yeah. What is that like? Because, you know, people in Durham are very protective of Durham and the scene here and the culture here. And there's tends to be a lot of backlash when something new makes its way. And I can't say that I haven't been a part of that, being alienating maybe towards new, just because it's big, it's scary, there's a lot of money involved with new developments, and people tend to think, oh, they're going to come in and ruin what's going on here. But for you, it may be a little different, just because you were here through a lot of that stuff, and so you're coming back not as a, you know, you're from Durham, but maybe you don't have that same protective instinct.
No,
in the way that some of your peers might have. So what is that like for you when people are like, "Yeah, I just moved here," or "I'm opening a new business here"? How do you process that?
That's a loaded question. You know, I mean, when I left Durham, I was happy to leave Durham.
Like, you got a lot of people were.
I left in 02, like that cookout on Hillsborough Road opened in like 2000, 2001, and we were ecstatic. We're talking about like a cookout. You know what I mean?
Spent a lot of nights in that parking lot.
Oh yeah, and I loved it. You know, I cherish those nights. You know, I always will. Great memories or whatever. But like,
but that
that's
was the
not
thing.
Where I wanted to be. You
right,
know?
That was the thing to do.
Yeah.
Even in 2008 when I graduated, it was like, well, what are we gonna do tonight? Oh, I guess we can drive through the cookout parking lot and see who's there.
It was a party, man.
Yeah.
I'm glad that lasted for some years there, because I know we have some years between us. But so I don't know. I mean, I get back here and a lot of the people that have built these kind of bars that are the concrete base or restaurants for like, you know, social places, mm-hmm. a lot of them aren't originally from Durham.
Right.
So it's like, all right, so you've been here a decade or 15 years. Like, what difference is it? Like,
right.
In 10 years, these people will have been here for 10 years. And like, but that question that you're asking also like brings up gentrification a bit, which is never easy. But at the end of the day, I'm not going to lie, I really like cool places to go, you know? And that's the unfortunate part. So it's like, I'm not upset at new people moving here. I'm not upset about new businesses being opened. I'm excited for that. I'm excited for both those things. But like, how can that happen and not like be totally detrimental to some of the families that have been in these areas that are changing, you know? And whoever has the solution to that is like,
they can make a lot of money.
Speak up. Yeah. Because I think people on all sides are trying to figure it out at this point. So
I think that you're right about, that folks that are moving here, they're moving here because of what, has been built here, the kind of culture and scene that exists here that they want to participate in. And so we shouldn't be defensive or ashamed that the thing that we think is fun and enjoyable is something that someone else that doesn't live here would also find enjoyable. And that's, but it's a hard switch to flip, because you are worried that people are moving here, and depending on where they're moving from, they're bringing certain aspects of their culture that maybe don't jive with what's going on in Durham. So you have this really interesting blend of people, but it is still a southern town, and there's a certain hospitality and culture that comes with that. And so people are, I think they're protective of that. To your point, they're protective of the families and the history here. All in all, I think the city's done a pretty good job of holding on to those things and trying to protect the infrastructure in that regard. So yeah, it's, and for you as a bartender, you have to be welcoming, right? People, you know, your livelihood is in some ways determined by you being welcoming to those folks to some degree. I mean, you don't have to be passive or like you're not theirs to command, but
right.
But it is, yeah, but you have to say, oh, it's cool that you're visiting from Chicago. Tell me more as you order three more drinks or food or whatever it is, and you know, leave
depending
a big
on
fat
how
tip.
Talkative I feel that night, maybe.
Yeah.
But no, there have been some really cool folk. Especially, it's real funny to see the ones that are there have actually made the jump to move, and all of them seem. I think, like you said, this being a progressive area, I think if someone doesn't really isn't down with the way that this place is, they wouldn't be coming, which makes it, I feel like it's just going to become more and more of a bubble compared to the rest of the state, or most of the rest of the state, which is fine by me because, you know, I like the atmosphere here. You know, I think it's still a very diverse place. And growing up in Durham, I think that's a very important thing to note too, is that it's always been, you know, racially diverse and also economically, or financially rather. Economically, what's the right one?
But either
one of those words,
yeah.
Diverse place, and not too far one way or the other. A lot of the time, of course, that happens. But
yeah. Well, and especially in the public school system too. I mean, having gone Poe to Brogdon to Riverside, I was Arne Harris to Brogdon to Riverside, and
gotcha.
Then Durham Tech and Central. So you know, I've hit all the public institutions that we have to
like
offer.
Durham, man.
But yeah, to your point, it's always been pretty diverse, and that's what part of the story of Durham and what people are trying to hold on to. So
yeah.
So thinking about as you're moving through New Durham, you connect with some folks in the music scene and start having these beat making showcases through a group called Raund Haus. What's like the cut and dry? Because there's a lot of stuff out there at this point about Raund Haus, but what's the genesis of that group and why was it important for you guys to found, you guys and gals, I should say, to found this organization and really push beat making and producers of that nature into the forefront?
I mean, that style of show where it's more beat driven, instrumental, whether it be hip hop or electronic, I personally believe it all began with the LA cats mostly, you know, and from there it kind of spread. And while I was in Japan, it became really popular too. And the beat shows there were great. But then when I got back here, I met Randy Trandall at the skate shop, Board Paradise.
Yeah.
This is Board Paradise, like 18-year-old Randy. Somehow we started talking about making beat making, and I think like it wasn't like immediately, it's probably like 6 months or more went by, and then like we finally like kind of kicking it, hanging out on the porch talking about making beats, sometimes making beats, like showing him stuff with like the MPC or whatever, you know, gear I had at the time. And eventually it was like, let's do some beat shows. It had been happening here, like there had been a few. I know Rodney Oak City Slums out in Raleigh was doing some shows here and there. Some people, I think Josie and Randy were doing some shows in Durham here and there, but like none of it had really like been, had like a solid foundation and kind of like vision perhaps.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not too sure, but.
One, DJing was because I remember coming out of Dirty Durham, one of the big arts collectives here, they were doing Party Illegal and there were all these dance shows. Yeah. But it was more in that space, sort of like the EDM dance techno.
Right.
They had that really locked down and there was a big scene for that style, but there wasn't the beat makers, these sort of more, I don't say traditional, but it was just a different style of music.
Yeah.
Didn't have the platform, to your point. There wasn't a foundation there. The shows were happening, but it was still very underground. So one of your founders, David Huber, has spent some time in LA, and you mentioned the LA beat scene and guys like Flying Lotus, who you also mentioned earlier, were
MySpace,
very heavy.
Baby.
Yeah, shout out MySpace. Were very prominent in the LA scene. So David ends up here in Durham. How does his time in LA influence sort of the direction of Raund Haus, to found this group?
That'd be a question for him mostly. The group, Randy and I had like talked about it, and David happened to be sitting there, and he was like, "Yo, I'll help. Like, let's do this." And like, little did I know, this dude is like a mastermind in organizing and making shit happen.
Yeah,
you know, that's
because he's not a Durham guy. I think he's from St. Louis. Yeah,
yeah. He definitely was the, you know, if Randy and I had kind of like made a concoction of stuff, ideas, like he was the catalyst to get it to actually start and go.
Yeah. And I think that's to your point about people moving here and bringing ideas, opening businesses. It's nice to have an injection of new ideas into a scene, you know, for him to bring that kind of perspective from a bigger city, from LA, where this is happening routinely. You have experience from your time in Japan, so you're mashing all these different things together to create what people now consider a big part of the arts and culture scene here. Raund Haus, yeah, and sort of the beat makers.
Damn, thanks.
I absolutely think that.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, and part of that has to do with Party Illegal kind of sunsetting a bit. Right. They were doing less shows for a while there. Some of their folks moved on to do other things, moved away. And so there was a gap for producing, for DJing.
Yeah.
And I felt like Raund Haus really took up the mantle. And
it's really different. Some people would show up to Raund Haus and they'd really be looking to like dance. Mm-hmm. And these were like people I knew.
Right.
You know, and they'd come in like 15 minutes. They'd like come up, be like, "Yo, we're going to kind of go, like, we're just trying to really dance. Like, this shit's too weird." And it's like, fair. You know what I mean? Like, they definitely wanted that more like basic, like, you know, DJ party kind of vibe. And I there's still plenty of people doing it. And I know Party Legal kind of pops up here and there with stuff still. Shouts to them for keeping it monthly for like 4 years straight.
That was really, really impressive.
That's crazy.
Yeah. And they did a really good job of recruiting folks to come play outside of the area. And that's something that you guys took on as well, that I really found interesting and admired. And we, at Runaway, I say we got to work with you guys on a couple of those shows, bringing guys like Techloon and Astronautica to this area, to again add just like a little bit different dynamic to what we were already cranking out here. It was there were so many artists and have continued to be part of Raund Haus that I had no idea existed.
Yeah, nobody would have
until what you guys really did, and something we worked on at Runaway as well. And I think that's why some of those shows really made sense, was because we were both in the business of trying to expose the art scene to new audiences.
That's a good way to put it. Yeah, totally. Got some fun stuff coming up in that sense too.
Joe Rue coming down. Raund Haus is 4 years old now. It's crazy to think.
It's almost three.
3 years old.
It'll be three in February.
Okay.
So it took me and Randy a while to figure out the idea, and it took a while for David to get here, I guess.
Yeah.
So
I remember going the first show at the Shed.
Yeah.
Which unfortunately no longer exists, but the Shed out in Golden Belt, and I don't know how many people fit in there. 60 people.
60s.
Yeah. It's a decent size sort of coffee shop vibe venue. But it made a lot of sense for what you guys wanted to do, because it was very much it wasn't a dance party. It was a come, not, you know, nod your head to these guys that are just like in their rooms cranking out beats, just really experimenting in their own laboratories. And this was a space for them to get feedback, to showcase their work. But it wasn't a party. It was a good time, but it was more of like a open workshop almost for these producers to come and show what they had been working on. And for other artists to come and see, okay, like, what can I, how can I fit into this equation? Is there an opportunity for me to rap over these beats? Can I remix some of this stuff?
Yeah, none of the rappers showed up, man. I don't know what's up with that.
Was that something that you guys were looking for?
I thought all the rappers would be there. Like, yeah. Oh, snap. There's a night of beats. I can go poach some beatmaker.
Right.
Well, nah, none of you rappers showed up, except a few of you. I'm not going to pick and choose who hasn't. But
the style is different. Yeah. I mean, it's I would say that a lot of the Roundhouse producers are more in the traditional boom bap style.
Or two off electronic.
Or right. Probably. Yeah. You know, some of Slum's stuff, even though he's produced for rappers.
Yeah. He did one on Juice WRLD's recent one.
Yeah. And he and Pat Jr. Work pretty closely together. So he can definitely produce hip hop records.
No, that dude can do anything, man. He'll give you a pop record.
Right.
Like, straight up.
Yeah.
That cat's talented.
But to your point, the beats are just different. Yeah. Shout out Slums. So I'm not surprised that
the rappers didn't show up. I thought that would be what it was. Because, I mean, ultimately, I'm trying to find a rapper to work with, which this is in the works.
Yeah,
so
a little bit.
I will be in project mode
about
soon.
What's coming up for Roundhouse.
For Roundhouse?
Yeah.
Roundhouse, we have this coming Saturday, the 3rd. We got Joe Rue coming down from Virginia and two of his crew up there. These guys are super talented. Can't wait to have them. And at recent Roundhouse stuff, we have been adding hip-hop acts. The after party at Beats and Bars included Dawood Salim, Ebbs doing a vocal set, which was dope, and the homie Camus Leonardo, really one of my favorite people in town. And then the after party at Hopscotch, we had Brass, Juice WRLD, and Dawood Salim once again. So, like, incorporating more, like, performance-type things in Roundhouse has been pretty fun. Just because, like, I got kind of sick of head nodding the whole time. Like, occasionally you might want to hear, like, a put your hand in the air or something. You know, granted, no one's doing that much these days. But it's fun to have a voice and a new focal point, like, throughout the night, you know, not all of the night.
Yeah, so. I mean, the label is evolving, and it is a label now. It's not just a label now. Collective or sort of a group more loosely. There's a, there's an opportunity to really put out some really cool records, and you guys have done that this year. Slum's new EP is a full record EP?
I can't remember.
Yeah, came out on Roundhouse this year. Foot Rocket
like Tree
early
City,
this year, right? Yeah, Tree City.
Collapse was the beginning of the year, I believe. But and then this party coming up is to celebrate the Joe Rue's album release. So
you guys are continuing to grow this label. David moved to Texas, out to Austin. Still comes back every so often, and it was really nice to see him over at Surf Club. A few weeks ago, doing his thing. That guy, man.
After Art of Cool.
Can DJ forever. I don't think he's a heavy Red Bull drink or anything like that. It's just the music gets in him and he just plays and plays. And
yeah.
Nonetheless, you guys are continuing to crank out events, new music.
Yeah. We got I can't quite say names yet, but December, we're bringing someone from out of town that I'm looking forward to a lot, and we'll see something similar happen in February too. So keep your ears open for that stuff. A goal of mine would be to get on the road with it, honestly, and go to other cities, but that's a bit more difficult. It's just some of the artists here, like, there's a lot of talent, and like, these people need to be heard, you know, outside of this area. Totally. So
just tell them to put their music on LimeWire. Somebody
I wish,
find it. Or on MySpace.
That's how I would have found MySpace it page. In 2001, 2000. But yeah, that's kind of what's coming up for Roundhouse. For myself, I think there's whispers of Juice WRLD and I doing a little trivia night.
Interesting.
Quarter Horse on Thanksgiving.
Okay.
So we'll see what happens with that. That's just it's an idea that we've been cooking up. So it's that'd be one hell of a trivia host.
Juice WRLD is an entertaining guy.
Yeah.
I have good faith that you and he, if you're cooking up something, it'll be interesting to say the least.
Oh yeah. So we'll see. We'll keep everyone updated on that as well.
Yeah, we'll be sure to share that out on the website and all the social media and all that as well. Nick, thank you very much. This has been an awesome experience. You got one more thing?
Well, I mean, I don't know. I was thinking that that whole, like, I'm counting down the day, like, when I can't take the politics out here. And, you know, I'm like, fuck it. I have to go back to Japan. It's pretty awful.
So this interview then may be the last time anyone ever hears from you.
Yeah, this is
You might just pack up and leave tomorrow.
I voted. Oh, I voted this past week. So I hope y'all voted for these local.
Very, very, very important.
Elections. Hoping to make things better.
But if not, Japan has your heart and we may never see you again.
Yeah, just boom.
Maybe I'll go too. I've always wanted to go to Japan, so
escape this political climate. Anyway, that's my last thing.
Yeah, no, and we will certainly have you back.
Go vote.
We didn't even. Please go vote. We didn't even get to talk food in Durham, which is something that
we'll do that again.
Yeah. Well, and maybe there's a spinoff podcast opportunity here for maybe we should get a couple more episodes before we start talking about spinoffs. But I know you and I have had numerous conversations about what you think about certain food here and just the food culture here in general. So I do really want to dive into that, but we'll save that for part two, another episode with Nick. Nick, again, thank you for coming on the Buddy Ruski Show. It's really fun to say that now, the Buddy Ruski Show.
No, thanks for having me.
Absolutely, absolutely. And make sure you check out Raund Haus. As Nick's discussed, there are a ton of cool things coming out of that record label, events, new music, trivia nights even. So be on the lookout for that stuff on their social, their website. I'll make sure to get some of that stuff up on our site as well. If you haven't already, check out the Patreon page for this podcast and a whole lot more in the future. That's patreon.com/buddyruski. You can support this show and a whole lot of other content as well that I hope you are enjoying. If you haven't, sign up for the newsletter. That's where all the secret information about who's going to be on the show comes out. So go to the website, buddyruska.com, sign up for the newsletter, and we will see you guys next week. Peace.
Go vote.